When we think about stress, we generally think about the psychological aspects. But stress is a great example of the mind-body connection. Stress can have a direct impact on our mental and physical health, and there are a few things as potentially damaging to a person's well-being than prolonged exposure to stress. If you watched my general overview video on stress and health, I talked about knowing the difference between the good stress we have in our lives, or eustress, versus the bad stress, or distress. It's important to recognize the difference between the two because distress is far worse for your health. The way in which our bodies respond to stress helps us better understand the connection between stress and our health. When your body responds to stress, it triggers a chain reaction that starts in your brain with the hypothalamus gland communicating with the pituitary gland. The pituitary gland is located very close to the hypothalamus, but is considered part of your endocrine system. The endocrine system consists of a series of organs called glands that are located throughout your body and release hormones into your blood. The pituitary gland is the master gland of the endocrine system. So when these two are activated by a stressor, the hypothalamus can cause a response in your brain, and the pituitary is able to create a response throughout your body by signaling for the other glands to release their hormones. During a stressful event, the pituitary gland sends a signal to your adrenal glands, which are located just above your kidneys, and it tells it to start to secrete two very important hormones. Because this process involves the hypothalamus triggering the pituitary gland, which then triggers the adrenal glands, it's known as the HPA axis. The two hormones that the adrenal glands release are known as epinephrine and cortisol. These are the two hormones that are most associated with the stress response. We talked about epinephrine before when we covered biopsychology, and we discussed it as being a neurotransmitter. Well, it's also secreted into your blood as a hormone. Historically, we used to refer to the hormone as being called adrenaline and the neurotransmitter as being epinephrine. However, now we just use the term epinephrine. Both epinephrine and cortisol help our bodies deal with stress, but do so in a slightly different way. Epinephrine is what is typically involved in the immediate fight or flight response, or what is called the sympathetic nervous system. This is what causes our hearts to race, muscles to start twitching, breathing to increase, and a whole host of other things that literally allow us to either fight or run away when facing a threat. Cortisol plays more of a supportive role to this process. It sends signals to other parts of your body that especially helps regulate blood glucose levels so that your body will have the energy it needs to maintain the fight or flight response. I like to think of these two hormones as being like two friends camping in the woods. Epinephrine is the friend that is putting wood on the fire, while cortisol is like the friend that is foraging, trying to find more wood to add to the fire later. One is responsible for the actual fuel for the fire that is burning now, while the other is responsible for the longer-term maintenance of that fire. This is exactly what happens when our sympathetic nervous system is activated and we enter into the fight or flight state. Epinephrine starts to cause our immediate reaction, including the beating heart, increased respirations, higher blood pressure, and even increased muscle tension. All of this is geared towards immediate survival. However, it can also be hugely damaging to your health. The changes I just mentioned puts added pressure on your heart, blood vessels, muscles, and respiratory system. Cortisol adds to these health concerns by essentially stealing resources from other systems of your body to further prepare to continue with the fight or flight response. This means other functions of your body, like the immune system, digestive system, and others, suffer. In fact, if you ever felt really nervous and had that sensation of butterflies in your stomach, you're directly feeling the effects that these hormones have on your digestive system. Cortisol, in particular, is referred to as the stress hormone because its effects can last so long and it's triggered more by stress rather than an immediate threat. How your body responds to stressful events can be best summarized in the general adaptation syndrome. When we experience stress, our bodies go through a process that is called the general adaptation syndrome. Some people are a little confused by the term syndrome because we think of the word as referring to an illness or a disease. However, the way it's used in this sense is more like a change in the way your body functions. The way in which your body responds to this process is what the general adaptation syndrome specifically refers to, and it can be broken down into three stages. Those stages are alarm reaction, stage of resistance, and the stage of exhaustion. You can remember them with the mnemonic, the three stages of the general adaptation syndrome are, where the A stands for alarm, the R stands for response, and the E stands for exhaustion. During an alarm reaction, your body is immediately rising to the occasion. This is the initial triggering of the fight or flight response that leads to all those physiological changes that we think of when we feel threatened or scared. Both epinephrine and cortisol are being released and causing an effect throughout the body. As that begins to fade, your body goes into the stage of resistance, where it's remaining on guard and is prepared to respond, but isn't necessarily experiencing the same reaction it did when there was an imminent threat. Epinephrine isn't really being released or causing an effect in this stage, but cortisol is. This can sometimes go on for a long period of time. After all, think of something like the prolonged stress involved in a person experiencing health issues, or money problems, or going through a divorce. This type of chronic stress, although not as sudden as that immediate reaction we get in the alarm reaction stage, tends to really wear a person down and lead to burnout. One way or another, the stage of resistance eventually will stop. Either this is through the threat or the potential threat subsiding, or simply through exhaustion. When chronic stress leads to this period of exhaustion, you are definitely in a period where you're beginning to really start having damage to your mental and physical health. It is precisely for this reason that it's critical that a person know how to identify these stages and then take measures to properly manage the stress they may be dealing with. If you'd like to know more about some of the different things we look at with managing stress, check out the video I did on it. You can find the link for that video below. Thanks for watching, everybody. Have a great day.